When Gordo was flying on his Gemini 5 flight in 1965, he took thousands of photographs of the Bahamas. He was looking for something. Here's what I gotta show you. So I'm comparing these photographs with the chart that Gordon gave my dad and I. And if you see that the majority of the numbered areas are concentrated right where these pictures are taken, in the Bahamas. I've got Grand Bahama, Dead Man's Cay,
Great Isaac's Cay,
Guincho's Cay,
Long Island,
Hogsties again, pictures to the tune of thousands. And they all line up with the chart. They coincide with the chart, they're coinciding with shipwrecks, and if there's coinciding with shipwreck, it coincides with treasure. And the next time you see me, that's where I'm gonna be, in the Bahamas.
There it is, site one. I waited a long time for this, guys. Really long time.
So Gordon made this master chart from space. He went down and he dove on those sites. Here in the Bahamas. He drew maps and illustrations of what he saw, but the technology wasn't near what it is today. And that means there's more stuff out there. And now it's our job to finish what he started.
All right, ready to deploy the bag. Deploy the bag.
Deploy the bag.
So a magnetometer is a sensor, and what it's doing is sensing the magnetic field of the Earth. And so if you take a piece of ferrous metal, something that's magnetic, and put it in the magnetic field of the Earth, the mag senses that difference, basically. And so if you have something that's small, it disrupts the field in a small way, and the mag will sense that. And if it's something large, like a cannon or an anchor, it'll sense that in a larger way.
We utilize it to find metal-based shipwreck material. Does not include silver and gold, but once we find the metal-based shipwreck material like cannons, anchors, and ballast pile, that will lead us to shipwreck gold and silver.
So right now, that's 4 feet off the bottom.
That's awesome.
So fortunately, the mag comes with a really awesome piece of software, and we use that to integrate with the GPS, and then what we do is we set up a grid pattern that we actually mow the lawn, we call it, and so we'll set the lines up, and then we'll take while we're out on site and just mow the lawn with the boat.
We have an idea of what we want to see, but we never know what we're actually going to see.
Shipwrecks don't just sit in one location. They can be driven onto these banks in horribly fierce hurricanes, scattered for miles. You know, you just got to pick up little bits and little clues wherever you can and, you know, piece them together.
$2,500. Yeah, that's a zinger.
Holy.
We got a lot of hits.
Given the amount of targets that we have in this area and given the water clarity, I think, Mike, don't you think it'd be a good idea if we tow two guys behind, start off that way?
No, that's smart.
Okay.
We cover a lot of ground that way. We can check a lot of these targets.
Yeah, that's the plan, guys.
We're getting so many mag hits. It'll take us literally all day to dive on all these hits. So towing's gonna save us time and money. It'll help us identify targets a lot quicker. And with our expertise, it'll be easy for us to identify targets that are laying on the surface.
Right on, brother.
Right on, right on. Let's go,
let's go.
Dive.
Here we go.
Dive is in the water. We're gonna go and start towing.
This is the advantage of having seasoned treasure hunters work with me. We're gonna be able to see stuff that no one would be able to see.
We look for straight lines. We have a saying that there's no straight lines in nature. So, you know, when you're trying to train your eye and look for stuff on the ocean floor, you look for that nice straight line. It's a good indication of something man-made.
Stop.
This entire area has lots of wreckage in it.
The shit's everywhere, man. It's fabulous.
Those kind of targets mean we're gonna need tanks.
I'll be glad to put you guys down.
I'm good.
The survey, it doesn't discriminate whether it's an early or modern period shipwreck. So we're encountering a lot of modern material, and it'll throw you off.
It's a long trip. It's at the end at a 90-degree angle.
This is from a modern trawler. Nothing from Gordo's list of 11.
Does it look modern?
Aha. That's nice.
Pretty good size square cut nail.
It's interesting, you don't see both of them together all the time.
The square nails that we discovered were used to construct ships between 1500 and 1650. That means we may have found wreck number 1, 3, 8, or 10 on Gordon's list. And if that's right, we could be looking at least 45 tons of treasure. So we're gonna stay here and focus on this area. We're gonna dive on the surrounding mag hits until we find another artifact from that same era.
Daryl, do you copy?
Look, Jim, this Catalyst right here. Only one so far.
Did you find anything around that? I've got something here.
Daryl's got a hit.
Hey, Jim, what is this right here?
And you found a cannonball.
That was exciting. It's in the period that one of the shipwrecks on that list, which is, that excites me.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of...
My heart's thumping. The cannonball is a fantastic clue that there is a shipwreck, a period shipwreck. We'll be able to establish a line or a trail, so to speak, that will lead us to the final resting spot of that shipwreck.
Well, there should be a lot of stuff that we found in this area, right?
There certainly should be.
Let's just fan this whole area and make a straight line. I don't want to just wildcat it. Let's go find more of this stuff.